Welcome back to Let's Play Facing the Wall. Welcome back to Let's Play Obduction Blind. I'm the RPG chick. We are now going to see if this works, and hopefully we don't crash a lot. So I don't know if I have to manually press these buttons here, or if it's going to bring me to a separate input thing, but I'm going to press Farley's house number back, which is 6341. Hold up. Yeah, I have to do it like this. And the controls is weird, so sorry. Hey, hey. Now I realize also we can go back and talk to, what's his name? I think that's CW? And it... In the vault. Now that we turn the power on, he might say something to us. Oh, look at that. I do wonder where we are, but I don't want to leave just yet. It looks like... You're kidding me, we're back at the... We're back here in her house. The community center. Which I'm guessing doubles as her house, maybe? I don't know. Okay, so we've got an entry canyon. I guess we came through here, right? It drops us off here, whatever that thing is. Water source, falls, battery, shop, CWs, right? Is that where the vault is? Town, Farley's, which is here. So we got this wall. So we went all the way around this. There's this tree, I guess. Tower, Bosque, Bleeder, Lake, Fuel, Supplies, Scrapyard, River, Plateau. And this is a wall. I want my, corner back. You know, a wall. Leads up to the tower near the tree. Alright. Cool. That's a better map of the area. I will look at all this stuff. Seed information. Oh! This is that thing that got us. So that's a seed. Oh, ambassador seeds. Ambassador seeds were first documented about 150 Earth years ago. They occur about once every 400 days if the trees remain healthy. Natural seed swaps occur between pairs of seeds that, we now know, drop simultaneously from healthy trees in paired sphere. When each seed was touched by species in sphere, the swap occurred, sending an ambassador from each sphere to the paired sphere. Wait. So that tree that we saw on the map, these seeds, the things that brought us here, bring us here? That's where the seeds come from. So the seed swaps occur between pairs of seeds that drop simultaneously from healthy trees in paired sphere. What do they mean by sphere? Are the spheres like, is that the, like the different planet on the other side, like that force field? Is that a sphere? And this is a sphere? When each seed was touched by species in sphere, the swap occurred, sending an ambassador from each sphere to the paired sphere. Location of the swap is defined by the locations of the pairs of seeds. After the first swap, the seeds recharge quickly, allowing for a quick return. First meetings were intense but naturally short. It was quite a surprise for both the Mofang and us. Oh, okay. Well, so the Mofang and them, the spheres not only bring you from Earth to here, but from here to other places and other people who are not human beings to here. Over time, the spheres required more and more time to recharge, producing longer visits between species. Everyone who arrives is familiar with the collector seeds. The bright light that we were all drawn to right before the event that brought us here is a collector seed. Okay, not an ambassador seed. What new arrivers may not be aware of is that these seeds, like all seeds, come in pairs. When the tree drops a collector seed on the ground, it signals that its twin has begun its quest for a new being. That search may take years, or it may take hours or years. Its twin, okay. So the twin from my sphere that brought me here is looking for a new being, or has found it already. When an appropriate situation, a natural threat of death is found, the seed activates and swaps a smaller but varying size sphere from Earth or whatever appropriate home world here to Hunrath. As Hunrath became more populated, we would watch for a newly dropped collector seeds, collect it, and place it in the entry canyon area. This allowed us to provide a more predictable entry experience for new arrivers and provide a single area to collect any resources that may have come along with the new arriver. Unlike ambassador seeds and mother seeds? Collector seeds do not seem to survive. The inner core is spent, leaving only the lifeless outer husk. Yeah, it seems like that would be that way. Mother seeds. Postulated but unverified. First suggested by Alima Hamsa, 2232 BH. The notion of mother seeds extrapolates the behavior of the lesser seeds to a super seed. I get it. That's a pun. Super seed? No, just kidding. She posited that the process that actually created the paired spheres, was similar to all other swaps, but on a much grander scale. Sorry, that the spheres and the seeds are getting mixed up in my mind, and the swaps. The idea is that two seeds from a mother tree, were scattered on the galactic winds to find appropriately similar environments. When matches were found, some process was triggered that swapped large portions of landscape between vastly different worlds. Alima further noted that the tree's location in the center of the spheres suggested that the trees grew from these mother seeds. Because of the similarities, it has been conjectured that reswapping the entire environmental spheres might be possible with a larger scaled version of the ambassador seed machine. And that's it for that. Communication. Talking with our neighbors. We take communication for granted, even with the varied languages we find here in Hunrath. But when we suddenly find ourselves among other intelligent species who don't share our culture, history, DNA, or vocal cords, it requires a huge amount of effort for the beginning of rudimentary chatting. This quick overview will set the stage for what to expect when communicating with our neighbors. Left-handed. I personally would put the arrow here. Mofang. The Mofang were the first non-humans we met. With at least some level of similar physical vocal generating abilities, they picked up human words quickly. This early mimicry resulted in what the species became to be called. Even though they were able to mimic single words and simple phrases, it became evident over the years that huge grammatical differences were not easily overcome. Mofang. Why were they called that? Mimicry? What were they mimicking that sounded like Mofang? Some have proposed that the difficulty may have arisen because the Mofang insisted on attempting to learn every human language and as a result were never able to lock onto any consistent grammatical structure. Nevertheless, in spite of the rudimentary sentence construction, it has been very easy to communicate, and it has been unnecessary for us to learn their language beyond a few simple phrases and proper names. If you'd like to learn more about communication with the Mofang, please contact Tam. Villein. Right. Heard a little about the Villein technology, I believe. it in that building up near CW's, I'm assuming CW's, vault. The Villein have presented a particular communication challenge. From what we can gather, they produce sounds using two large reed-like structures inside opposite sides of their heads. The vibrations generated are channeled to resonance chambers in their skulls, where they are combined into a complex low-frequency dual tone. The low-frequency bitonal sounds are not only hard for humans to hear and resolve, but impossible for us to mimic. And the Villein's hearing is also orientated towards low-frequency, so they are unable to hear most of sounds associated with human speech. Therefore, communication with the Villein has relied on technology. They have adapted consoles, which the Villein fluently control with vocalization, for use by other species. Over the years, some individuals of other species, including a few humans, have learned to communicate very effectively using this method. Humans have been able to pick out some higher frequency characteristics of certain key Villein words over the years, and although we can't speak to them in a way that the Villeins can understand, we are occasionally able to hear and recognize these words when spoken distinctly by the Villein. If you'd like to learn more about communication with the Villein, please contact Vito. Am I going to be meeting all these people and meeting all these aliens? Arai. None of the stages of the Arai morphology have any vocalization apparatus. Because of the obvious synchronization of the barnacle flash and the ability of the pawns to provide for and address the needs of the polyarchs, I have no idea what this is referring to. It was assumed the species could communicate effectively. It was not until Farley began to spend large amounts of time in the polyarch antechamber that the first clues to this communication became evident. After months of research, Farley began to have limited success with receiving some kind of simple messages that were coming from the polyarchs. It is apparent now that the polyarchs had been attempting to communicate the entire time, but they themselves had been experimenting with various channels until they got a message from Farley. After this breakthrough, others were able to tune into the polyarchs and learn to listen. Both the polyarchs and the pawns have a simple organ that can sense human vocal frequency, enabling them to send simple responses from humans, but over the years Farley was able to learn to speak to the polyarchs via a related form of extrasensory transmission. Really? If you'd like to learn more about communication with the Arai, please contact Farley. That's it. More to read. Species description. Cool. Mofang. Through ambassador seeds, the Mofang were the first non-human species humans were introduced to. N. Liang was the first to call the alien a Mofang, impressed with their advanced ability to imitate our sounds, movements, and mannerisms. Although they have a name for themselves, their language is mostly unpronounceable by humans. As a result, and because of their mimicry abilities, communication with the Mofang is primarily accomplished by their learning human languages, rather than humans learning to speak Mofang. They have been able to learn almost every human language represented in Hunrath, enough to present functional, if rudimentary, communication. The Mofang basic external morphology is remarkably humanoid, bilateral, symmetrical tetrapods, bipedal, head with anterior facial features, mouth, eyes, nostrils. Other external features include minimal body hair and raised dorsal protrusions. Constitution is somewhat frail, due apparently to their thin and lightweight internal structure, but internal investigation has not been possible. They have ample cranial space to account for a substantial brain, and their intelligence is impressive, as evidenced by their advanced technology. So the Mofang are the ones who try to invade these people, invade their home here, and they're at war with them, and then he started battening down everything, and then what happened? They've left, they died, killed everyone, except for CW. Mofang, okay. I'd probably be a little afraid if I encountered them. Arai. After a certain level of maturity and health of the tree, a passage opened at its base. This passage allowed contact with two additional species. The first contact was with the Arai. The first contact revealed the Arai to be large beetle-like insects. We were unable to communicate directly with them in any way, but they appeared to have some rudimentary level of intelligence. It was Loring Toth who first made the journey through the heart to Kapdar and named both the New World and the inhabitants. The Arai have three distinct variants that have come to be referred to as Barnacle, Beetle, and Polyarch. Okay, well, this is making more sense now than reading about the other one first. Three distinct variants, Barnacle, Beetle, and Polyarch. Although their morphology is dramatically different from human, their internal systems, like all our neighbors, are supported by similar atmospheric composition and basic nutrients. In their barnacle stage, the Arai are completely immobile. The Arai stay in this egg-like development state seemingly indefinitely. In order to hatch, they must be in proximity of a polyarch and fertilized by the beetles after a certain stage of maturity. The beetles are the eyes and ears, hands and feet. With only a minimal nervous system of their own, they're essentially the sensory extensions of the immobile polyarchs. So they're both immobile? The beetles are the only ones that move? They're able to execute simple commands, but apparently have very little in the way of individual sentience. So the barnacle and the polyarchs are immobile. The only ones that move are the beetles? How odd. I wonder why. Oh my. Now, which does this represent? Is this a beetle? Or a polyarch? Or a barnacle, even? Oh, no. Don't know. Oh, that's the poly... Can I go back? Oh, I can. Maybe this is the beetle? The Arai polyarchs are the intelligence and consciousness of the species. Although it was obvious that there was intelligence behind the species, it wasn't until Carolyn Farley began spending large amounts of time in close proximity that deeper communication began. With a room nearby, Farley was the first to communicate non-verbally and learn much about the species, including some historical information. The Arai species survived in their world while several other sentient species came and went. Among them, an ancient species who formed a deeper relationship with the Arai, carving temples and dwellings for them in the rocks, and later a more recent species that took over much of their homeworld. This latter species was especially adept at mechanical construction, using it mostly to capture and process large flying creatures using the beetles as bait. Huh, that wasn't very nice. So these are the polyarchs, I'm guessing? I'm guessing that's beetle and polyarch, I don't know. The final species to be discovered were the Villein. The Villein had been communicating with the Arai for many years through ambassador seeds, but became part of the larger community very shortly after the Arai. With a large and imposing frame and a form of communication based on a complex multi-voice, low-frequency rumble, the initial introductions were intimidating. After several attempts, Emily Vidal was able to begin some rudimentary communication and began visiting the Villein in Marae, which she named on a regular basis. She discovered a complex and amazing society that was able to use their technology in unexpected ways. They had the ability to quickly transform their world using extruded structures based on some form of complex miniature substrate material. Unlike the other worlds, the Villein sphere is scooped out of a Villein resettlement group that was preparing to set off into space to find a new homeworld. This was their way of life, to put themselves into stasis and scatter themselves through the stars. As mentioned previously, their appearance is imposing, standing about 9 feet tall, with a distinct reptilian resemblance. They have 6 limbs, 2 muscular legs and arms, and a smaller set of arms. They control every aspect of their technology with their vocalizations, but over the years, they have created control panels based on their number system that allow other species to easier access... easier access elements of their technology. Oh, wow. Yep, they're rather big. And imposing indeed. I like how it stays at the page we left it at. Eh. Got something on the floor here. Can I pick that up? Guess not. The entire landscape outside of our circle of desert could only be described as alien. Right, this is what we've seen. Past the force field or whatever the hell it was. Large floating rocks could be seen in the distance. No one had ever seen anything like it, anywhere on Earth. We fully explored our new surroundings, hoping to find a way home. No way home was ever found. In fact, we soon discovered what we take for granted now. Not only could we not get back home, but we also could not access the landscape outside the desert. Curiously, we discovered that a flow of water was provided from a high point of rock, and we discovered a small tree growing in the very center of the circle. Our central tree that is so important to our lives here was just a mere sapling back then. I feel like I should be able to, like, turn this, but nope. I shall document the curious events that have transpired with myself, my family, friends, and co-workers. Hartnell, so funny, that's the name of the, William Hartnell was the first doctor, the actor's name of a, you know, Doctor Who show. Hartnell was a peaceful mining town founded by my grandfather and nestled within the red rock of the desert in the Arizona Territory. Yeah, I'm saying it looks so much like Arizona. Or New Mexico. Its 163 inhabitants heard a mighty explosion on the night of June 27th, 1903. I sent several workers through the town to verify that the explosion had not caused any injuries or damage to mining equipment. They returned and reported that it must have been a loud clap of thunder caused by dry lightning, for they found no damage. It was not until the light of the next morning that we were amazed to realize something profound had indeed occurred. At some point during that night, our entire mining facility and the large circle of the land around it seemed to have been scooped up and carried off to a completely different place, all without anyone knowing about it. All right, so this is page one, and this is two, obviously. So I should have read in left to right. Would have made more sense, but I didn't. Anything else I can look at? There's books. Thought I heard a noise, but I'm not sure. That door cannot open because we have stuff in the way, I guess. What is? Why? Why? Why is that there? Anything else? Wait. What? Shadow in the way. So what do all the dots mean? Okay. I'm supposed to go there? Oh, we turn it. We can turn it. It's a boob. What if I put it on the 15? I don't know what it's supposed to be accomplishing. You're supposed to tell me... I seem to get stuck. Oh. You got me, man. Welcome. What's that say? Something to the end? Soulmates to the end. Wonder who that is. Judd? Welcome to Hunrath. Please give us a bit of information about you so we can get to know you a little bit better. Name, date you came from, please use 4-digit year. Where you came from, country and city, circumstance under which you were taken. Please note any danger you noticed. Emptied and filed. Whatever that means, 12,000 AH, 13,000 AH, 15,000 AH. What does that mean? Samuel Karen, January 2017. What was this recently, if this is... If we're playing in present day, Manakara, Madagascar. I had just arrived and was driving my supply truck along the coast south of Manakara when I recall being washed away and the seed appeared. 15,257 AH. Male, 61. Are these years? Is this a different measurement of time? Uzio, I think? Regenbogen? 1942. Oh god, 1942 in Lübeck, Germany? March? The last thing I recall is a large rumbling while I was hiding in the cellar of a vacant building. I ran toward a bright light in a stairwell. 15,841 AH, male, 26. So, 15,257 is 2017, and 15,841 is 1942? If these are some alternate... What is AH? If this is some alternate measurement of time, it's going backwards. After Hunrath? I don't know what it stands for. Maria Gallego, 9-1988, Cozumel, Mexico. Isn't it Cozumel? Not Cozumel? Looks like an E. On my boat in bad storm. She doesn't have much to say. 16,023 AH, female, 46. Jane Quayer? March of what? 2042. Portland, United States of America. Skiing. Mount Hood. 16717 AH, male, 37. Wait. It's not the age. 2042 is 16,000. 16,000. Does each number correspond to a person? Portland, United States of America. Where you came from. date you came from. Wow. Wondering what the hell the AH is. That's bothering me because I want to know what that means. Could that be 15,000 AH? I don't know. I just want to put that one back. Oh. It kept me on the last page I went in, which is pretty cool, but still. AH. Very, very perplexing. Light stays on. Oh, we've got an old-style cassette player. The record button is broken off. How convenient.